Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Here we are today on our first installment about the topic of al-qada and al-qadar, or as known in English, the decree and predestination, or fate and predetermination. As I have already mentioned in the introduction installment, speaking about and discussing this topic is extremely dangerous because it delves deep into Allah's actions and deeds. The smallest error will lead to a world of troubles, and any misunderstandings will lead to a total catastrophe. Getting the decree and predestination wrong will make a person live within the walls of confusion, chaos, and uncertainty. As such, and to really get the grasp about this topic, we need to go at the lowest possible level and build up. Because the decree in itself is not an easy matter. And as I mentioned before, all the groups and all these troubles that happened before occurred because people differed about the decree itself and also the attributes and names of Allah. So the decree and predestination, was it really of any importance at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Were people that much interested in the decree? Were they asking too many questions as we do today? Were there any confusions at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? This is a very, very important set of questions worth asking at the very beginning. And that's because so many ahadith have been mentioned in regards to this topic to emphasize the importance and the great importance in the belief about the decree and predestination, and also the rewards and punishments about such belief or the lack of. The ahadith in questions and sayings from the scholars and everything will be discussed as we progress in the series, because if I spoke about the topic in one go, it will still take about 5 to 6 hours, and I am sure you don't have that kind of time to listen to a series in one go. So inshallah, slowly by slowly go there, and I also don't have all the time to put the researches and everything in 5 to 6 hours in one go. So we go progressively slow, and every time we build up until inshallah we get to the final bit where we recap everything, and by then inshallah you would have grasped the real meaning of the decree and predestination, what it is meant with that, and also how it can help you in your life today, and how it can also play in your life in the hereafter inshallah. The best way to look for the value of this topic, was it really that much of an importance at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is to look in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here is the reason why. Any hadith that you read today, either in al-Bukhari, Muslim, or any books of al-hadith, any sayings of the scholars, anything that you can read today, was written in the 3rd century after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even the school of thoughts, the 4 schools of thoughts, did not come at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or right after. Abu Hanifa came at least 80 years after the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as you can see, there is a big gap in time. So for us really to see if something was of an importance at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first stop would be the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because all the people and all those who documented were not at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be able to tell us if this topic was or was not of importance. And at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as I said, there were from time to time issues that people wanted to know about. Either just because the Muslims were mingling with other people, because in Al-Madinah there were different cultures. It was a cosmopolitan, small, tiny city, but nonetheless there were many different groups. For example, the Muslims, the Arabs, would see how the Jews would do certain things, and the Christians and the pagans and this and that. Different tribes that came to Al-Madinah for business also had their own cultural values that were different than those of the Muslims at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or those who believed in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time there. So whenever there was an issue, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will point that out to us in his book. Directly, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the term yas'alunik, i.e. they ask you about or they question you about, it was mentioned 13 times, directly like that. Otherwise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also mentioned when they ask indirectly questions, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always answers. And since the Messenger has no authority, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to answer from himself in topics that weren't mentioned in Al-Quran or explained. Because if something was already explained in Al-Quran, there was no point for the Sahaba to ask and Allah answering. They would ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he would answer. But if a topic was not in Al-Quran, as simple as asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the orphans, how to treat them. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not have an answer about that topic, he would wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals something to him. I will quickly tell you those 13 things, questions. And when I say questions, it was not an individual question. Because if it was only one person that asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran would have said, وَيَسْأَلُكَ, i.e. and he asks you, or وَتَسْأَلُكَ, and she asks you. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ, it is a group of people. If not, it became an issue in the community. Like the public opinion wants to know about something. So where do they go? They go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to get the answers. So for example, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَهِلَّةِ, and they ask you about the crescents. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always says, قُلْ هِيَ مَوَاقِيتُ لِلنَّاسِ, say these are to help people make up for times and calculate times and things like that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals the Quran to answer back the question as to what the crescents are. Another question, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ مَاذَا يُنْفِقُونَ, and they ask you, what should they spend? What should they donate? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away say, قُلْ, straight away say, Allah answers, and the ayah comes in. For example, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الشَّهْرِ الْحَرَامِ قِتَالٍ فِيهِ, and they ask you about the sacred months. Are there any battles in them? Allah straight away says, قُلْ, again, say, and Allah answers, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delivers. Another ayah, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ, and they ask you about, الْخَمْر is any intoxicant, and الْمَيْسِر is any gambling. And then Allah subhanahu straight away also answers, قُلْ, say, and the answer came after that. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْيَتَامَ, they ask you about the orphans, say, again. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضَ, and they ask you about menstruation of women. قُلْ, say, because the Arabs, the Medina, they were mingling with the Jews, and the Jews have some tradition about the menstruating woman. I've already explained this in one of my pep talks on my YouTube. Please go there and check the women series. Also, they ask you about what is made halal for them. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ مَاذَا أُحِلَّ لَهُمْ, what is made halal for them? Allah straight away answers, قُلْ, again, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, and he answers that question. For example, they ask about the hour. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّنَ مُرْسَاهَا, and they ask you about the hour, when will it take place? Then straight away Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers, قُلْ, say, and the answer came right after that say. Also, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَنْفَالِ, they ask you about the war, the spoils of war. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away answers, قُلْ, and the answer comes after that. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ, they ask you about the spirit. Again, قُلْ, and Allah answers after that, قُلْ, say. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ, قُلْ سَأَتْلُ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا, I will tell you some little bit about it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals about him. وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْجِبَالِ, they ask you about the mountains. How will they go on judgment day? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also answers, قُلْ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers. So as you can see here, the topics that were important and that had gathered public opinion big enough for people to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and for Allah to answer, none of these topics was the decree and predestination. There was no question whatsoever about Al-Qadr. Nobody asked. The reason being was because people at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam totally understood what the decree, because they read the Quran, they listened to Al-Quran, they heard, and before that, they well knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not put on them any restrictions when it comes to their free will. So nobody ever dared asking Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the decree and predestination, and Allah never answered. So as such, the companions radiallahu anhum never asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about how Allah does things. And as I said, the hadith that we will discuss as we progress in this series, inshallah, all of these hadiths have been worded and designed in such a way that they fulfill certain desires in the hearts of certain people, certain agendas, and all this, inshallah, shall be revealed as we go along. So the question to ask here is the Qadr, the decree, part of our faith? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to believe in the decree and predestinations as He commanded us to believe in Him, the messengers, the angels, the books, and the last day? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ask us explicitly to believe in the decree, and if someone rejects the decree, then they are considered kafir or whatever it is? And before answering this question, I would like first to introduce you to a couple concepts that are going to help us greatly in understanding this topic. There are certain terminologies that are being used these days, and they have been used for a long, long time. And these terminologies have really taken us away from the path of what Allah wants us to be. In the early days of Islam, after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, came Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and then came Umar radiallahu anhu, and then came Uthman radiallahu anhu, and then came the fourth Khalifa Ali radiallahu anhu. At that time, the highest authority, and that is Amir al-Mu'mineen, also was the most knowledgeable person, or at least that leader had a lot of information and knowledge about Islam. And most of the issues, he could take care of them by himself. Sometimes the Khalifa would call upon other companions to help him decide on an issue. So there was always two in one. So the highest authority when it comes to power, and also the highest authority when it comes to Islam. And back then, the Khalifa, or the great leader, also was the great imam, i.e. he would lead the people in salat, he would give the khutbah of Jum'ah, he would lead salatul Eid, and so on and so forth. But enter Muawiyah, the son of Abu Sufyan, things changed entirely. Muawiyah became a king after the assassination of Ali radiallahu anhu, and after that assassination, and to be accepted within the community, as we shall see, he recruited the services of men who were all competent and accomplished in Islam. And as I said before, Muawiyah was the first leader to create paid sheikhs, paid scholars. And then he would give them the khutbah, and he would tell them what to preach to people. And that is how they helped him spread what he wanted the other people to know. So for now, we will leave Muawiyah for a little bit, and we will get back to him, inshallah, later on, because his fingerprints are all over the issue of the decree, the Qadr, and other parts of our belief. And you won't believe how much he has affected what we believe in these days. Let's start with the first word that has no basis in Islam, that never was mentioned in the Qur'an, nor was mentioned in the sayings of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but is heavily found in almost every book written about our belief. In fact, this word has been present for the last 1100 years, i.e. 11 centuries. This term is none else but the word aqidah, or what is translated today into creed. And first thing first, this appellation for this term was not even used at the time of the Messenger, as I said, nor was it used or existed during the Khalifa's time, the fourth Khalifa, not even existed at the time of Muawiyah and his dynasty, which ran for 90 years. The term Aqidah was used as a substitute to the word Iman, belief, that is mentioned in Al-Qur'an, because Allah in Al-Qur'an, He doesn't call these things aqidah, He calls them iman. And as such, why has it taken the place of an iman? Why today you hear people say, oh, he has the correct aqidah, the wrong aqidah. But hardly ever you hear someone says, oh, they have the correct iman or the wrong iman. And this is because on the 3rd century, our scholars were faced with many powerful, deep and challenging debates and ideologies that came from prominent and outstanding scholars from different Muslim thinkers at that time there. And either because the Muslims have read in different other translated books from the Persians, Romans and all the Greeks and everything, or because by reading the Qur'an they came up to a certain conclusion, as I will mention inshallah in a little bit later. So the problem our scholars faced was that they couldn't attack someone's belief. No one could tell, oh, they have the wrong belief, because the other person simply believes that there is a God, Allah, and that they believe in the last day, in the prophets, the angels, and the books. As soon as someone tells you, I believe in these, then he is a believer. Now, the scholars can't attack someone based on this. So they looked right and left, and they invented a new term, and that new term is wreaking havoc until these days, and that term is the word aqidah. Because now when you say, I believe in Allah, they tell you, okay, but what type of aqidah do you believe? Do you believe that Allah, for example, has fingers? If you say yes, they go, okay, you have the right aqidah. I talk about these issues, inshallah, later on when I speak about the divine attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and essence, and I'll explain these things. So I'm just giving an example here. But if someone says, oh, I don't believe that Allah has fingers, nobody can say that this person has got the wrong iman. But they will tell you happily that this person has got what? The wrong aqidah. So the aqidah was a term invented to be able to attack a person, and so many people have been executed and killed just because they were classified as people who have the wrong aqidah. And that problem exists until today. I hear, like, you go online or you hear people say, the Salafis will always tell you that you must marry someone with the correct aqidah. Make sure they have the right aqidah. But they don't dare tell you, make sure they have the wrong iman. And aqidah became a dividing word that has divided Muslims for the last 1100 years until these days. As if to say that what Allah has told us to be, believers, is no longer sufficient. And I had so many experiences with this type of group when to them being a Muslim is no longer enough. Someone even told me once that Allah has named us Muslims, but it no longer is enough. You must be a Salafi and you must identify yourself as what part of Salafism you are from to be a real Muslim. And all this, wal-iyadu billah, are nothing but absolute lies, because Al-Quran denies all these kind of things, and we will see them inshallah later on. So attacking someone's iman is something that the scholars cannot do. But attacking someone's aqidah, they have a get out of jail card. They can do what they want with that, and that is okay for them. But attacking your iman was a charge no scholar would want. Therefore, attacking your aqidah is very doable. And this is the big problem we are facing today. So always bear in mind the term aqidah is an invented term. It's an innovated term. So much so for what people call innovation. For little thing, it's an innovation, when as a whole belief is built around the aqidah, and that term is, waliyadu billah, innovated. Understanding this term and how it's used is extremely important, because the belief in the decree in Al-Qadr equals the right aqidah. Now, and the absence of it equals the wrong aqidah, which then implies to the group I'm talking about, that this person is not of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which then means that this person is a deviated person from the right path. And then that person there, since they are deviated from the right path, they are not a Muslim, which ultimately means hellfire. But all of this cannot happen when the word iman is used. No one can take someone out of al-iman as easy as they do it with the term aqidah. The sad news is, until these days, our days, a very particular group keep pushing the term of aqidah with all of its implications on the bigger picture, to make it seem as an important, vital, and Islamic term when it only was and still is a political influence term, to remove and when possible destroy the opposition to a politically created group. And this is how it's always been, and this is how it is now, and this is how it's gonna carry on if we don't put an end to it. Another term that we need to know the origin of, because it equally is used to fragment the Muslim population today as it did in the far nights and the distant time exactly when Muawiyah, the son of Abu Sufyan, became the first king. That term was used then to segregate and separate Muslims and is still doing the same here, and that term is the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. At the time of Muawiyah, these two terms, which are combined today, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, were not used together. It just was used Ahl Sunnah and the Jama'ah. It was not Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. It became a full title again in the 3rd century at the time of Al-Mutawakkil. I shall come back to it in a little bit. But for now, I'm going to speak about how Muawiyah devised three slogans that were beautifully, when you look at them from the external, but deep inside them, they carried a poison, and that poison exists, believe it or not, until today. So how did these two terms, i.e. Sunnah and Jama'ah, come to exist? Who coined these two terms? When was they coined? And if this appellation came from Al-Qur'an, has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named us Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah? Or has His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam named us as such? Well, first thing first. This appellation, i.e. the Sunnah, or Jama'ah, just like the word Aqidah, was not used at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor was it or did it exist at the time of the four Khalifs either. The term of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah came, as I said, in the 3rd century at the time of Ja'far, son of Muhammad, son of Harun al-Rashid, and aka also known as Al-Mutawakkil. And this man here kinged for 15 years from the year 847, i.e. Christian era, to the year 861. And he is the fifth grandson of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. In the 3rd century, a fierce intellectual competition erupted between the great minds that existed at that time. Topics were influenced by external ideologies, and with the translation of foreign books, the Arabs were suddenly finding themselves in the seats of law upholders, and a confrontation talks between the other one about geography, maths, beliefs, creeds, and suddenly the Arabs, or the Muslims, found themselves exposed to Greek gods and Christianity and Judaism in more depth. And some Muslim scholars became more intelligent, and topics started erupting, discussing the attributes of Allah, because there was one group that pushed one side of the equation and the other groups retaliated. And we will see again this one when I speak, inshallah, about the attributes of Allah and His names. But anyhow, so the term Sunnah and Al-Jama'ah, but what does this title mean? At first it seems, as I said, a very benign name. It just interactively created that these people belong to the Sunnah and Al-Jama'ah, and it's a great thing to be and to be part of. The Ahl Sunnah wal-Jama'ah term was coined in opposition to and to exclude other people, such as the Mu'tazila, the Shia, and other groups that didn't subscribe to that particular aqidah that was held by the political government at that time there. And obviously the scholars always worked in conjunction and in harmony with the government. And the dark reality is that the king Al-Mutawakkil, who was also falsely called Amir al-Mu'mineen or Khalif or something like that, just a title, just like in Saudi Arabia today, it doesn't matter how murderous the king is, they still call him the subservient of the two holy shrines so that they make it religious. But back then also, whoever ruled was called Al-Khalifa, but in reality they were just kings. But anyhow, Al-Mutawakkil was a hardcore pro-Muawiyah, and so were the scholars that claimed the title of Ahl-Sunnah. After all, the Islam forged by Muawiyah was good to kings and was designed to help them keep the kingdom safe and protected. It was all about the throne, and the fact is it's still on until today. The term of Sunnah was used and known individually at the time of Muawiyah, and so was the term of Jama'ah. But as a combined two words title, it, as I said, it was only on the 3rd century. Muawiyah is known to be one of the most clever and cunning men that the Arabs of that era ever knew. He was a governor of Syria for 20 years from Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman. And then for another 20 years, he became king after the assassination of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. Muawiyah had cunningly used three beautiful slogans for three manipulative and vile agendas. The first of these terms was obedience, atta'a, which you hear the Saudi scholars today pledge to their king every year. They go and give him the pledge of atta'a. And Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, the Sunni world, always pledges atta'a, obedience to the ruler. But where does that term come from? Well, as you would mean, it came from Muawiyah. At one point in existence, and this is in our books of at-Tarikh history, it's in Ibn Athir, Ibn Kathir, Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, al-Tabarani, all these scholars speak about this topic that I'm going to talk to you now. So it's not taken from the Shia or any enemies of Islam, as it's always pointed out, like anyone who speaks the truth is an enemy of Islam, who wants to destroy Sunnah, wants to destroy Islam, nothing of that thing there. But these are facts that exist in our books. The ignorance of this fact has led us to where we are today. Scholars manipulating us, and we don't know why they do what they do. We don't understand, but they have their reasons. So let me tell you why the obedience is so important today, and why Saudi Arabia today, like always, like any other king until back to Muawiyah, anyone who does not obey is put to jail, executed, killed. Muawiyah used the term of ta'a, obedience, specifically to mean something. We all know the companion Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu, who died himself, and there are some ahadith that tell that say that Abu Dharr will live alone and he will die alone on Judgment Day. He will be resurrected alone. Obviously, that is not true, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say that in the Quran, and we all be resurrected at the same time. But once I tell you why they said all this to justify the exile of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, you will understand and you will have an idea about how back then, whenever something was politically right or not right, they would fabricate a hadith for it. And today, these hadiths are authentic, as they say, in al-Bukhari and Muslim. But back then, they were all politically invented, motivated hadiths. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari alayhi rahmatullah and radiallahu anhu was a man who didn't know fear. He was a man who spoke always against evil. So when Uthman became the 3rd Khalifa, he ruled for 12 years. The first 6 years, he was doing fine. But the second 6 years, things started getting bad for Uthman. And he started making errors. And those errors, they were companions that were against him, namely our mother Aisha radiallahu anha and few other. But all these things, they get hidden from us, because if we say this, the Shia will know. And all, but subhanAllah, how much of our history is hidden. But anyhow, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari was very hard on Uthman, because Uthman would make mistakes, and Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu would admonish Uthman, and he would do it very rough. He was also an anti-Muawiyah, because Muawiyah also had a lot of evil happening in his time. So that is before when Uthman was still alive. So Muawiyah was just a governor. So even after the death of Ali radiallahu anhu, Abu Dharr was also very hard with Muawiyah. And there were some followers to Abu Dharr al-Ghifari. So when Muawiyah as a king saw that Abu Dharr was gaining some popularity and people were rallying behind Abu Dharr against Muawiyah, and then Muawiyah took a very negative stance towards Abu Dharr, and Abu Dharr was living outside. So to cut a long story short, Muawiyah had to take pledge from people. Ata'a, obedience to me, i.e. being against Abu Dharr. And the scholars are there when they say we obey, what they mean is we obey Muawiyah and we revolt against Abu Dharr. That concept exists still today. When the Salafi scholars tell you ta'at waliyul amr, the obedience to the ruler, they always go back to that initial think and be against anyone who resembles Abu Dharr. And Abu Dharr was a great man, subhanAllah. It's just politics, and scholars have always murked it up and messed up our world, and it's unbelievable how bloody their hands, both of them, are. So that is the one. So the ta'ah, the obedience, is always against Abu Dharr or anyone that does anything that resembles to what Abu Dharr did. The second term of the three is the word sunnah. The word sunnah used by Muawiyah did not mean the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What it meant was the sunnah of cursing Ali radiallahu anhu openly on every Jum'ah. At the end of the Salat, Muawiyah, his son Yazid, and then his son Muawiyah, and so on, until for the 90 years of Banu Umayyah, where they ruled, they would curse Ali. And these are not kind of like from Shia books, they are in Muslim, they are in our books of history, subhanAllah. So Muawiyah would use the term, the Sunnah. So when he says, do you follow the Sunnah, what he means is, are you a cursor of Ali ibn Abi Talib? The first one to have ended this curse and this horrible deed of the Sunnah as by Banu Umayyah was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz alayhi rahmatullah in the year 87. So it's almost towards the end of the dynasty of Banu Umayyah. Have you noticed every time you go to Jumu'ah when the Imam gives the khutbah, towards the end, as they ended the khutbah and after they make dua and everything, and they would always end their dua, and just before the salat, inna Allah ya'muru bil 'adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun udhkurullah. And remember this? Well, the one who put this is Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and he substituted the cursing. At the time of Muawiyah and the dynasty of Banu Umayyah until Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, at the end of the khutbah, they would curse Ali. Just before the salat, they would curse Ali. So when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz alayhi rahmatullah came to power, and he ruled for about 2 years and a half, and he was killed, poisoned by his own people. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, why do they call him the fifth Khalifa? It's because first, he ended the cursing of Ali on the minbar every Jum'ah. And two, he stopped Banu Umayyah taking the taxes, or what is else known as jizya, both from Muslims and non-Muslims. It's unbelievable what they did, Banu Umayyah. They used to tax Muslims and non-Muslims alike, and they called that jizya, and he returned some of that money to people, and he did some other good things, alayhi rahmatullah. SubhanAllah, if Umar ibn Abdul Aziz hadn't stopped the cursing of Ali on the minbar on every Jum'ah, today we would be cursing Ali, because what's happening until our time these days is that the school of thought of Muawiyah is still alive. This is why Saudi Arabia is in battle with Iran, with all the people around, with Egypt, with all these things, because the Muawiyah school of thought exists until today. Now, up to the third word now of the three, and that is the usage of Al-Jama'ah. Again, for Muawiyah and the people that existed with him and around him at that time there, the word means specifically those who gathered, agreed, accepted, surrounded to Muawiyah. They called Amul Jama'ah, the year of the Jama'ah, i.e. the year where all Muslims gathered around one king, and that is Muawiyah. And that is why they call it the Al-Jama'ah. Later on, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they will bring the two together, and by the Sunnah they will mean something completely different than Muawiyah, but Al-Jama'ah stays almost the same. Now we can ask, is the belief in the decree and predestination a pillar of faith? i.e. if someone does not believe in the decree, they are not considered as a Muslim or a believer? Well, in the famous hadith of Jibril, where the narrators claim that a man came while the companions were with the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that this man asked very specific questions. What is al-Islam, he said, and then the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered that you do this, you do, you know, the salat, la ilaha illallah, zakat, and hajj, and so on. And then they claim, and I say they claim because there is an issue with this hadith, I will bring it later, and then they say, what is the belief? And they say that Rasulullah ﷺ responded back that the belief is that you believe in Allah, the last day, the books, the prophets, the angels, and that you believe in the decree, the good of it, and the bad of it. This hadith has been played with greatly. And since it was reported and transmitted by meanings only, and that the wordings of this hadith and others are totally and sometimes completely at the mercy of the person who tells them, absolutely no guarantee that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has truly said this hadith the way he said it, with the words he said it. People report only with what they understood, and they report in their own words. The well-known hadith of Jibril states that the pillar of faith are six, and unlike the Qur'an that says they are five. And this hadith is always reported, and they tell you it's reported by Bukhari and Muslim, agreed upon in other terms. But in other terms as well, when the hadith is reported by Bukhari, it's different from the one reported by Muslim. And we will see, inshallah, as to how these two hadith are different from each other. And as such, when this hadith is mentioned, we cannot say it is agreed upon because the versions are not the same. However, our scholars and those who preach, they always, either intentionally or not, they will tell you that this hadith is reported in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, but again, it's not the same thing, and I will explain what is not the same thing. The hadith in itself in Al-Bukhari and Muslim is reported from two different people. In Al-Bukhari, it's reported through Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, and in Muslim, it's reported through Abdullah ibn Umar, and then who says that Abi, i.e. his dad, Umar ibn al-Khattab, told him. So in Muslim, it comes from Umar ibn al-Khattab, and in al-Bukhari, it comes from Abu Huraira. Now, however, the hadith in al-Bukhari, it does not have that you gotta believe in the decree, the good of it or the bad. And you can go and check in the book of Al-Bukhari, and you will see that the hadith exists of Jibril, but this little sentence that you got to believe in the decree, the good of it and the bad of it, does not exist in Al-Bukhari at all. However, of recent years, the books printed in Saudi Arabia have been tampered with. So if you find in Al-Bukhari that it says it, please double check the edition of the book that you're reading and go online and double check. You will not find the hadith reported in Al-Bukhari with this expression. However, in Sahih Muslim, in the book reported by Muslim, this sentence that you should believe in the decree and predestination, the good of it and the bad of it, exists in Muslim. So the idea of the hadith exists in Bukhari and Muslim or agreed upon is a very deceptive and very manipulative technique used by our scholars, as I said, intentionally or not. Now, the other point with this hadith, my dear sisters and my brothers, is that this hadith is called Hadithul Ahad. It's a singular hadith. What this means is, with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were a lot of people that were at the time of the event, if this event took place. Because as far as I'm concerned, and as even though it's reported in Bukhari and Muslim, the hadith itself does not bring anything new. All that it mentions is already in Al-Quran. But I'm going to go with, let's say that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did say this hadith truly, and he said it, but not in the wordings that got to us. With Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a group of people. Jibril alayhi salam was a man unknown to people, and this hadith happened in Al-Madinah. Now, the people of Al-Madinah, the Sahaba, the companions, they knew each other. It's a small, and they knew people from the surroundings. Also, when people spoke, they had different dialects. The tongue, the Arabic tongue, has different dialects, just like English, like any other language. So when the man spoke, the companions would guess where he is from based on the way, the tone of his voice and tonality and all this accent and things like that. Now, this man comes, he is dressed in white. That is the time, the desert, it's dirty. But this man comes as if he came from dry cleaners. His clothing are spotless and they are totally clean. This is Jibreel alayhi salam. So the Sahaba, when they saw him, his face they never saw before. His features, the dark features, they never saw them. He is absolutely fantastically beautiful. The way he is dressed is immaculate. It's absolutely perfect condition. Everything white and beautifully dressed. So the Sahaba are totally thrown. Who is this guy? Never, and also the conditions at that time in Al-Madina would not allow somebody to be in that state. At least he must have some dust on them. If they were riding a horse or a donkey or a camel, they would be dusty, the land and things. But Jibreel alayhi salam had absolutely nothing. And when he spoke, he could not place his accent. So it is obvious that this stranger was really, really a stranger. So with this hadith in mind, only Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu would report this story. Only one person of all the group? SubhanAllah, like this is like mind-blowing. If we were 600 people in that time or three or whatever, all of us would go to our house, to our wives, to our friends. We would talk about this incident. Yet, the hadith is only reported by one person, and that is Umar ibn al-Khattab. Even the one that is reported by Abu Huraira joins links with the chain of narratives and ends up with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And this hadith was reported by only one person. So when the person hears this hadith, they understand it and then they report it to the next with what? With what they understood. We have absolutely no guarantee that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had truly spoken these words. He could have said other words, but the way they were transmitted to us, they were transmitted to us based on what the person understood. This is why when Jibreel asks Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is al-Islam? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam answers back that it is that you say La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, you perform your salat, you do your zakat, and you fast your Ramadan, you go to Hajj. These are not the pillars of Islam. The Quran mentions at least around 11 pillars of Islam. That is the practical Islam. Otherwise, the universal Islam for all humanity is that anyone who believes in Allah, believes that there is a judgment day and does good, is a Muslim and is not doomed for hellfire. What by this, what I mean? In Al-Quran, and I will explain this inshallah later on when I speak about the creation of humans' actions, and I'll speak about certain topics. I will cover the Islam that Allah means when he says inna deena inda Allah, Islam, that the deen, in the sight of Allah is Al-Islam, and who is the Muslim, and why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considers anyone who believes in Allah and the last day and does good as a Muslim, and such a person at the time of death, if they have done enough good, the angels will descend upon them and they will tell them, do not be scared and do not be anxious about what you have left behind, where you are headed. We are awliya'ukum fil hayat ad-dunya, we are with you. This is not only for us Muslims who believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is for anyone out there, could they be Jewish, Christian, anywhere out there who believes in Allah and the last day and does good, that is the Muslim. So we are a believers because we believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and we believe in Allah, the books and the pillars of faith. But to be a Muslim, Jibreel would never ever utter something that is different than what is mentioned in Al-Quran, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would never ever agree to Jibreel saying something wrong, and he would say to him, you spoke the truth, sadaqta. And the Sahaba say, we were astonished because he asks him, and Rasulullah answers, And then Jibreel says, Sadaqta, you spoke the truth. Now, the hadith has been reported to us. There is a lot missing in that hadith because it does not work with Al-Quran. And scholars have had headaches upon headaches trying to explain this hadith, trying to justify, trying to give different meanings. Otherwise, subhanAllah, this hadith is very simple. Very simple, but the scholars have written books upon books trying to find out on how to reconcile between this hadith, other hadith, the Quran, and until today it's still a headache. So my dear sisters and my brothers, the well-known hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam cannot be used as an evidence that al-Iman, the belief in the decree and predestination, are part of our faith, because this sentence was added, as I said, from Al-Bukhari, was added into Muslim. Now, if you look a little bit deeper into the book of Muslim, alayhi rahmatullah, he mentions the reason behind this hadith. Now, a quick look into our books of history show us reasons behind the invention of this hadith. And I say the invention of this hadith. This hadith and its likes that force us to believe in the decree and predestination were purposefully invented to plant and reinforce the Jabriya or fatalism creed in the hearts of Muslims. And by fatalism, what it's meant is that you believe that all events are predetermined and therefore inevitable. And in other words, it is the belief that people cannot change the way events will happen, and that events, especially bad ones, cannot be avoided, i.e. Allah has decided what will happen to us and we will endure what He has written. We cannot avoid it. And this, subhanAllah, is a very dangerous term and belief that Muawiyah has worked day and night, and the scholars that he recruited helped him day and night to reinforce this fatalism belief in the creed of Muslims, and it exists until today. After Quraysh, in the persona of Muawiyah, the son of Abu Sufyan, forcibly and violently stole power from the family of Abdul Muttalib, or the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the persona of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and due to the huge number of local and regional revolts, there were a lot of revolts in the time of Muawiyah, people who refused Muawiyah as a king because he stole power from Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Muawiyah now is faced with revolts everywhere around him, in Syria, in Mecca, in Al-Madina, here and there, on all these places. So what he did, he recruited some scholars, financed them, and he was the first one to finance scholars, just like in Saudi Arabia. He decided what they preach to people, what to say to people, and whenever they don't have something, an evidence from the Quran, they would invent a hadith. And with time, and because they are scholars, they can easily fabricate chain of narrators, and so many hadiths that he created have become part of our Islam today. These scholars started by inventing hadiths to push for what Muawiyah wanted, as I said. And one of such hadith is the hadith of Jibreel, this one here. This hadith all served one general belief, and that is the kingdom of Banu Umayyah, which was started by Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. But what they told people was this, that this kingdom was built under the supervision and support of Allah, and that it always was in Allah's knowledge and intent that Muawiyah and Banu Umayyah should rule, and that all events that took place, the killings of Ali, the assassination of Al-Hasan, and all what has happened of the problems and all that kind of stuff, took place because Allah wanted it to take place so that Banu Umayyah become the rulers and kings. Al-Quran didn't say that. And with Al-Quran, they couldn't help themselves with these things. So the golden opportunity was to pass and address every saying with a hadith. All they had to say was, Qala Rasulullah, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and that passed on. This hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam was used then to force, as I said, fatalism on people, that what's happening is not of free will, it is forced and it had to happen. So Sahih Muslim, Abdullah, son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, sheds more light on the reasons behind the telling of this hadith. And I will take the introduction, but if you want to read more, you can go back to the book of Sahih Muslim. And this hadith exists in Kitab al-Iman, in the chapter of al-Iman by Muslim alayhi rahmatullah. Yahya, son of Ya'mar, said, كان أول من قال في القدر بالبصرة معبد الجهني. The first man who discussed al-Qadr, the decree, in Basra, and that is Iraq, which was against Muawiyah, was a man called Ma'bad al-Juhani. Ma'bad al-Juhani is a cursed man in the Salafi world. But anyhow, this man says, Yahya, فانطلقت أنا وحميد بن عبد الرحمن الحمري حاجين أو معتمرين. I, along with Humayd, son of Abdul Rahman al-Himyari, set out for pilgrimage or for Umrah. You see the problem here? The narrator does not even know if he was going for Hajj or for Umrah. How does he remember what happened in this? If he doesn't know if it's Hajj or Umrah. But that tells you how the hadith get transmitted to us. But anyway, فَقُلْنَا لو لقينا أحدا من أصحاب رسول الله فسألناه عما يقول هؤلاء في القدر. And then he said, and these two friends said to each other, if we ever met with one of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we would ask him about what's being said about the decree by these people. فوفق لنا عبد الرحمن عبد الله ابن عمر بن الخطاب داخلا المسجد فاكتنفت أنا وصاحبي. And we were favored to meet Abdullah, son of Umar, as he entered the masjid. So we took hold of him. أحدنا عن يمينه, one of us on his right, والآخر عن شماله, the other one on his left. فظننت أن صاحبي سيكل الكلام إلي فقلت. And then I thought that my companion or my friend had deputized me to speak for us. And so I said, so he said, now he's going to talk to Abdullah, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab. So he said to him, Ya Aba Abd al-Rahman, so this is the kunya, the father of Abd al-Rahman. إنه قد ظهر قبلنا ناس. There have appeared some people in our land, and this is in Basra, in Al-Iraq. يقرؤون القرآن. They recite and they are very well knowledgeable in Al-Quran. ويتقفرون العلم, and they pursue knowledge. And then he mentioned a few things about them that are good, and he told them they are this and they are that. And then he added this sentence. وأنهم يزعمون أن لا قدر وأن الأمر أنف. And they claim that there is no such a thing as divine decree and that matters happen despite all. So basically what Ma'bad al-Jahani is saying that is that Banu Umayyah did not get to the power and became kings because Allah wrote it and that it shall happen. No, they became kings because they took it despite of everything. In the Arab world, if you tell someone, I'm going to take it despite your nose, i.e. despite you, I'm going to get it. So what Ma'bad al-Jahani says is that Allah has not decreed that Banu Umayyah become kings and rulers, and that Banu Umayyah took this power and kingdom and everything by strength and power despite the dislike of the other people. And which is true. But anyhow, and then they say that Abdullah ibn Umar said, إِذَا لَقَيْتَ أُولَئِكَ, if you ever happen to meet those people, فَأَخْبِرْهُمْ أَنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْهُمْ, tell them that I have nothing to do with them, وَأَنَّهُمْ بُرَآءُ مِّنِّي, and they also have nothing to do with me, i.e. I am not of them, they are not with me, i.e. they are not Muslims. And then he said, وَالَّذِي يَحْلِفُ بِهِ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ عُمَرِ, by the one by whom Abdullah swears, i.e. by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَوْ أَنَّ لِأَحَدِهِمْ مِثْلَ أُحُدٍ ذَهَبَ, if any of them had owned the size of Uhud. Uhud is a huge mount in Al-Madinah. It's really, really gigantic mountain. So Abdullah says, if any of these people that don't believe in the decree and that they believe that Allah has not written that Mu'ayyah became king, then if these people had that mountain, a huge mountain made of gold, and they spent it for the sake of Allah, Allah will not accept it from them. ما قبل الله منه. Allah will not accept from him حتى يؤمن بالقدر, until he believes in al-qadr, in the decree. And then he says, حدثني أبي, and then he narrates the hadith of Jibreel, in which they say that you get to believe in the decree and predestination. And this is how they injected that belief in the decree and predestination despite of it all. Subhanallah, when you read Al-Quran, Allah never ever mentions the decree and the belief in the decree at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in, at the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, in the ayah 285, that is the surah number 2, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, آمَنَ الرَّسُولُ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ رَبِّهِ. The messenger has believed in what was descended to him from his Lord. وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and all the believers also believed. Believed in what? كُلٌ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ, all of them believed in Allah. وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ, and the angels. وَكُتُبِهِ, and in the books. وَرُسُولِهِ, and the messengers. And Allah did not mention here the last day, because throughout Surah Al-Baqarah it became evident that the belief in the judgment day is part of the belief in Allah and the pillars of faith. Later on, subhanAllah, in Surah An-Nisa, and that is the surah number 4, in ayah 136, Allah makes a completely different threat. And he says, وَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِاللَّهِ, and whosoever denounces the belief in Allah, وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ, and his angels, وَكُتُبِهِ, and his books, وَرُسُلِهِ, and his messengers, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and the last day, فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. That person there has certainly gone far astray. There are about 15 ahadith, so all of them, some of them are authentic, some of them good, some of them not so authentic, some of them fabricated, but these hadith, about 15 of them, all of them claim that if you don't believe in the decree and predestination, that everything that happens is already predecreed and everything happens just as Allah predecreed it. If you don't believe in that, then you're not a believer. Guess what? I'm not a believer then. I don't really care, because in Al-Quran, every single ayah in Al-Quran says that humanity has a free will. Every ayah. If I had to prove to you, I need to tell you the 6,236 ayah of Al-Quran. Remove few here, few there, let's say 6,000, and all of them say, otherwise, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatens us? He tells you, you do your salat. If you don't do your salat, then this is the punishment on judgment day. The simplest of question is, if Allah has written that I am going not to pray, why is he threatening me? He's already decided. And why is he telling me to perform a salat when he has decided that I am not going to pray? It doesn't make sense. And still they want you to believe in that. This is why today in Saudi Arabia, tons of scholars are in jail. And the other towns are still applauding the governor. The other day, a dear friend of mine, sent me this little clip where a Saudi woman tells this guy on a satellite TV station, who is just a host, she tells him, before you say the name of the King Salman or the Crown Prince, Muhammad ibn Salman, she told him, you need to make wudu. Because, subhanAllah, the wudu is just for salat. But in Saudi Arabia, in the Salafi world, the brain of people is so washed. Today, I'm listening to this debate between two scholars. One of them is Salafi, the other one is not. Subhanallah, the Salafi man uses some terminologies like, if you are man, and if you are man, you do this. And I say, subhanAllah, he's talking to a scholar. And this scholar is not somebody who is just normal. This is the Mufti of Al-Azhar. But then again, to the Salafi world, Al-Azhar and Egypt and all these scholars are not Muslims, because they are what? Asha'ira. And they get you into these little things. And inshallah, later on, I will discuss these groups so that we all know where we stand, how Al-Quran talks, addresses things. So to recap the whole thing, my dear brothers and my sisters, the belief in the decree and predestination is not a Quranic requirement, is not an authentic Sunnah requirement. The act of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam do say absolutely the opposite of the words say. All these ahadith were fabricated injected later on to support what Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, the first king of Banu Umayyah, and the guy who ended the Khilafah, the English ended it from the Turkish, but the man who ended the Khilafah from the Sahaba was Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. So don't fret a lot. If you don't believe in that, there is no problem. What you should believe in is already in Al-Quran. So don't be scared at all. On Judgment Day, when you meet Allah, just tell him, I believed in what you say, and you are absolutely safe, 100%. It's coming to the hour. I pray to Allah that this is clear. And wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. And until inshallah my next talk about the decree and predestination, rest in the mercy of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is again your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. If you want to just join the group, just send me a message on 078-7640-8735. If you want to discuss anything that I've said or debate or anything, please do feel free to speak to me. I am here and I stand behind every word that I said. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.